As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. It is time for us to examine the will be forever part of that phrase. I don't know about you, but as it is now, I hope will not be that way forever. An eternal life in this sinful, broken world, not my idea of a great eternity. But when you take the from the beginning part of that phrase, God's perfect pre-sin world, carry that into his kingdom on earth as we see and understand it today, his kingdom's in the new heaven and the new earth for all eternity, now you have my interest. So how do we live in this as it is now world, as both saint and sinner, struggling with our own sinner within, struggling with that new creation? With the will be forever in view. God has called us to love. By, as the text says, speaking the truth in love. Maybe a better translation of this, speaking the truth, really kind of, it's truthing someone is the way it would, even though we don't say that in English, it turns the word truth into a verb. It's to truth someone in love. What does that look like? It looks like living out our vocation. The text starts to talk about vocation briefly. Grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. He gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. So, what is your role in this now and will be forever sort of mindset? Now, all are called to some role. It gives here, again, the list. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. But thanks be to God that everyone is not one of these things. If that's all we had, we'd kind of be lost. What about all the great products and services that we're blessed with, because there are so many people with so many vocations, so many things that God has blessed them to do that they enjoy doing? Where would be the great food that we eat were it not for cooks and farmers and ranchers and truckers? Where would be the great buildings that we get to enjoy living in and working in and worshiping in were it not for architects and electricians, plumbers and general contractors? Where would be the great machines that make our society go without engineers and mechanics and factory workers? Where would be the great vacations and leisure that we either enjoy or often long for if it were not for entertainers and hotels and cabin maids and reservationists? Where would we be, where would our safety be without military and police officers and firefighters and rescue workers? Where would we be if we were not gifted with all these great things? Medical profession, garbage collection, sanitation and sewer, all of them very important to making the machine of society work. But a very important part of how we truth each other, if you will, is our family, our community, our church, and our work. Those relationships in those places define how we are to love God and love our neighbor. And it's important for us to realize this and not take for granted the things that God has placed in our lives. Here are some examples of what it means to truth others. In our families, as parents, siblings, children, grandparents, aunts, uncles, even cousins, or close neighbors who are almost like family to us, people that we stay close to and stay connected to. First, it involves changing diapers, feeding, clothing, and housing, teaching. It later involves things that a sinner doesn't want to hear. Don't touch that, it's hot. Don't stay out too late. Don't eat too much. Don't drink too much. Do not do what married people do unless you're married. Do not take a life partner for yourself of the same gender. Do not abort God's gift of life. Do not starve inconvenient people. While you are speaking much of this truth in love, I just went through a whole list of things towards the end that people are very uncomfortable saying and very uncomfortable hearing. You will be accused of being hateful and mean and judgmental. Who is a child in anger, hasn't gone to their room and maybe whispered under their breath, "I hate you." Or who is a parent, hasn't seen, "I hate you," in the eyes of a child they've just scolded. It is not loving to tell an unrepentant sinner to continue in their sin. That's not loving. It is also not loving to shun or scold someone for being a sinner, for we are all sinners. We are not called to be judges. That's God's work. We are not called to be prosecutors. That's the law's work. We are called to be truthers, those who speak the truth in love. Speaking the truth in love to those that we love will be, hopefully, those who will be with us in that ever after part of the phrase. Speaking the truth in love means telling sinners things they do not want to hear. For example, if a child looks at a container filled with bright yellow fluid, antifreeze, it's appealing to the eye and may even smell very good. But it would be unloving to tell the child, "You shouldn't drink that, but you do what you want. It's okay." No, the loving thing to do would be, "No, don't drink that. It's poison. It can kill you." And if it's a younger child, more than just telling them not to do it, you will take actions to prevent them from drinking poisonous fluid. In the same way, it is poisonous to a person's heart to live with and carry around unrepentant sin. To live in unrepentant sin is to say, "My sin is not sin and does not need forgiving. Being fat is not sinful. But being slothful and gluttonous and lazy is." Enjoying the gift of marital intimacy, not sin. But doing that same thing and not being married is. Giving the appearance that it might be going on by cohabitating, even if it's not, still harms the consciences of others and is still a sin. And while it is not a sin to desire intimacy with someone of the same gender, to lust after anyone you are not married to is sin. And when did our own desires trump what is most important for us? Being upset or disappointed because God has given you the gift of a child when you did not expect it or want it or desire it. That's not sin, but murder is. Being upset or disappointed because someone you love has become a great burden on you, that's not a sin, but again, murder is. This same requirement to be a truther, if you will, speaking the truth in love, applies to our role within our community. As students, workers, leaders, managers, coordinators, volunteers, neighbors, whatever your role. It applies to your role in church, secretary, newsletter editor, altar guild, web designer, ushers, greeters, parishioners, we all have a part. It applies to our work at work and with our co-workers, our employers and employees. So we can be kind and friendly to those who refuse to acknowledge their sin. We can work with them, we can be kind to them, we can live with them, we can play in fellowship with them. But our words and actions must be clear that we do not condone activities that are not in their best interest. We in no way will support or enable destructive behaviors. That's not a loving thing to do. So while a parent cannot tell an adult child how to live, they can refuse to enable and or tolerate sinful behavior in their presence. While a child cannot tell an aging, self-harming adult who is their parent how to live, they can refuse to enable and tolerate sinful, destructive behaviors. God has called us all in our vocations to love Him and to love others. In a unique mixture, each person in this room has their own roles, their own gifts, and they plug in a very unique way that God has designed. So do not make excuses so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness, or deceitful schemes. If we stand firm in what God has called us to do, we probably would never say things like, "I have done this exhausting task for long enough, it's someone else's turn." Because if we are doing what God has gifted us to do and uniquely plugged us into, we will enjoy doing it so much we'll want to do it either till we stop breathing or till we're no longer able to do it. And God may reveal to you a person with a particular skill in a particular place, someone else having that passion and that ability, and you can encourage them and walk them through it. There are a lot of things that others do for us that often go unnoticed until they stop doing it. That's not an opportunity to criticize or complain. That's an opportunity to realize and be thankful for what was done up until that point. And it's an opportunity to realize that maybe you have been taking that activity for granted. It may also be an opportunity to offer a helping hand to someone who's been doing something you didn't even know about. So that, speaking the truth in love, we can grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. It's no coincidence that God uses the example of the body when He speaks of the church. And this same analysis can permeate our whole existence, community, workplace, nation, world. God gave everyone a part to play. The pastor, "I don't know what it is God wants me to do." Well, first be still and know that He is God. Then take time in deliberate prayer to seek an answer to that question. And be prepared to accept that there may be more than one good option to the thing that you ask for. Maybe He's giving you two or three good options and going to allow you to pick the one you like best. And finally, be ready for one of three answers when you ask things for things in prayer. Yes, no, or wait. Now, we don't like no and wait, but they're answers, and we need to be ready to receive them when they come. Embrace the fullness of your vocation. Embrace the fullness of what God has gifted and called you to do in this life, so that, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Not an eternal life in this sinful, broken world. An eternal life in God's restored new heavens and new earth. The Christ child, whose arrival we anticipate, the Word made flesh, makes that beautiful will be forever possible. Makes it our sure reality in His holy name. Amen.